Okay, so to get a feeling of what is the sort of software we do, so we mainly focus on apps and mobile apps and web apps. So this is a typical example. So a banking app for the new generation for your personal finances and transactions. A self-care app for a telecom company that is big in Croatia. And this is also an interesting application where you can track your pill intake, your health, and your prescriptions from your doctor. So this is a sort of typical Infinum app. It's well designed. It follows the latest design trends. It tries to keep user experience at a very high level. So we try to make the best mobile apps possible. Okay, the QA team currently has 12 people. They're here. But when we started, we were much smaller team with much worse processes, and I'll talk about that later. So if we go back to 2015, let me tell you how life was like in a software agency then. Some of the parts that I'll say here are still true, so it's a bit crazy. So it's not a company that does two or three projects at a time. We do like 30 or 40 at a time. Some of them are big, some of them are small. Testers usually work on multiple projects simultaneously, so it's very rare that someone is working full time on one project, so we need to adapt a lot to that. We work for clients, so meaning the fact that we're a digital agency means that we do software for other people, so we do it for hire, and we have to meet both the client expectations and the user ones as well, which are not often the same, so they can be contradictory at times. It means we need to be very fast because our clients want to ship to market as soon as possible, basically, because every day you miss is a missed opportunity to monetize on some idea. Yeah, as I said, we do a lot of projects simultaneously, and they're all vastly different, so there's no really one way to do QA, and that's basically the main point of my entire talk. And we work both with startups and established businesses, so the projects vary, but the businesses vary as well. Startups come with very loose ideas, which we have to help them develop, and businesses actually come with their own sets of rules and principles and ways of doing both software development and quality assurance. Another thing that's probably very familiar to everyone working in software development is that requirements basically change on a daily basis, so that's something we have to adapt to as well. So even if not all of our projects might be agile in the sense of agile manifesto, we do have to adapt to these changes often on all projects, so we never have a very detailed set of requirements which we work with. We always sort of do it on the go. So this is a big challenge for the QA team, which traditionally really wants to know what's going to happen. So the motto of a typical software agency, whether in Croatia or anywhere else, is to move fast and break things so you can experiment fast and get to good results fast as well. And this is a bit of a problem for quality assurance, where we want to be sort of stable, know what we're doing, test that everything works, be very thorough about stuff, and here we have changes on a daily basis, so it's very, very hard to adapt to that. Okay, when I came to the company, this is what life was like. So there weren't 12 of us, there were actually 3 of us. This first person actually left after a while, so there was just 2 of us at a certain point in time. We were a much smaller team. We didn't have any testing processes whatsoever in 2015, so we were a very immature team. There was no real awareness for quality assurance in the company itself. I mean, they knew they had to have quality assurance, but they didn't really know why or how it should be done. It was more of a test and that's it approach. We as testers, and I see that people often have this problem, we're barely involved in the software projects we're working on, barely involved in the sense that we don't know what's going to happen, when it's going to happen, and how it has to look like. So we were always involved at the very end of the entire story, which in my experience is the worst possible thing you can do to a software tester, minimizing his impact on the project. And to add insult to injury, we also have high pressure timeframes. So it was always stressful, it was always test immediately, production is tomorrow, it has to be good, the client's gonna yell at us. So there was a sort of contradiction here that we were barely involved, but a lot of pressure was put on us to test quickly, verify everything, and give the green light for production. So it's a very bad environment for someone trying to learn sort of quality assurance and do it well. Also, the feedback we got from developers at that point in time, I don't know if you see here, it says developers, is that we were a pain in the ass, basically. I mean, we got along well, but on projects, we were the guys that coming in way too late with ideas, funny edge cases and problems that they had no time to really solve. So we were more of a pain than a helpful component of the project, even though we were absolutely necessary. The designers, for instance, they had no idea what we were even doing. So the design team, the people that do the UI and the user experience and that they create sort of the features for the app, they were completely unaware of what quality assurance means, what it is. They haven't met it before. They basically thought, okay, you guys tap around on the screens all day, find some bugs, and then you go home. So that's your entire job. And that was basically the sort of the company's view on the things as well in the very beginning. Project managers had a similar problem. They weren't really, they knew we needed to test something, but more or less they wanted to test it as quickly as possible so they can ship and send the email to clients, hey guys, we're shipping tomorrow, everything's fine, everything works. So that's sort of the feedback we got from them as well. So all of these are sort of negative aspects of working in an agency which doesn't have really mature processes, so it has problems. And QA doesn't know where it fits in the whole story. And neither did I. So when I came to the company, I knew some coding. I didn't have any previous experience in the field. And they basically asked, OK, this is my first day on the job. What should I do now? And the answer I got was, unfortunately, pretty bad. It was, here's this app. It was a mobile banking app. Now test it. So that was my sort of my entire onboarding. That was my entire first day experience, was to start testing. And I didn't know what testing was, where I fit into the entire scheme of things, how testing should be done. It was just, OK, here's this app. Test it. Find bugs. And I said, OK. I mean, what else could I say? It was my first day on the job. And what did I do? I tried to break it, right? I took a phone. I took several ones. It was a mobile app. I took several ones. I inspected some problems. I talked to people. I didn't really know what's going on. I knew that some things were wrong, that I could report them, that I could maybe talk to someone about them. But I didn't know how the app should look. And I really didn't know what I was doing, but I managed to break it, and it felt good in a way. But even then, on my very first day, very first couple of days, I thought this was not a good way to do things, right? To just test and have no clue about what's going on. But yeah, I was sort of successful in the next couple of weeks or months. I did sort of found hundreds and hundreds of bugs, so they were in there, but I wasn't really aware why they were in. My initial gut feeling was that people don't communicate very well, so most of the bugs were due to a lack of communication, which I came to realize later was basically the problem of all software development. It's not that people can't code or don't know what they're doing, it's mostly, okay, we haven't communicated something well enough. After a while, I sort of started being good at it. I found several techniques to do it. I talked to people. My experience grew. I started learning about mobile apps in general and software development in general. And I started asking questions, especially to my project manager and to the client, like, hey, guys, this flow, for instance, to enter in the app, it has too many steps. Can we shorten it? And the answer was always the same. There's not enough time. Or this screen is too complicated. It has too many features. Users will not be able to understand it. It's weird. In some scenarios, it doesn't even work. Can we make it simpler? And the answer I got was, OK, we don't have enough time for that. We have to ship. Or it takes too long to load. Can we make it faster? Not enough time. Our backlog is full of bugs, maybe minor ones, maybe UI ones, maybe edge cases. But can we fix some so it doesn't keep piling up? And there was never enough time. So the problem for me, it seemed that no one has time for quality assurance, right? We're doing some testing. Some of the major stuff is fixed. And everything else I was doing was really relegated to sort of the backlog, to the bottom of some list. And it seemed like there was never enough time to do things the way I wanted to do them. And I actually thought there was some sort of conflict, so that maybe the other teams don't like QA, maybe this is not really necessary, maybe we're doing it incorrectly. And I realized that the problem is that that's not the case, that people want to have this sort of team in the company, that we have a very nice place to live, but we had to adapt. So the way we were doing it is way too immature, and we weren't aware of the things that were going on in these projects we were working on. So this is the sort of tester we were, right? We were like rigid, slow. This is an old Lada, by the way. It works. It will get you to where you're going, but it's quite bumpy. It's not a nice ride. It doesn't have a lot of features, and it cannot really, it isn't what we testing should be in 2019, so we needed a different sort of vehicle for the projects. And usually, even in sort of what I think is a worst case scenario, is that QA is relegated to writing tests and executing them, and that's basically their entire job. And I don't think this is good, I think this is bad, but we were even worse than this, we were in this situation. So we weren't even writing any tests, we weren't really communicating prior to to refining any features prior to the development with anyone. We were just getting the complete apps in, executing whatever tests we thought were necessary with some minor details and minor information that could help us start with that process at all. So this was a really sort of bad situation. So all we were doing was basically doing exploratory testing, testing the app, and having very little influence on the rest. So we realized that there was need for some change, because the company obviously wanted to have good-looking apps. They wanted to have apps that users will actually want to use, that will have good retention rates. And we also realized that we are not the powerful all-saviors of everything on projects. So we realized we won't salvage a bad idea or a stubborn client, but we can make a good idea a lot better. And when I asked myself how, I realized by being there in time. So the problem was always that we were way too late to the entire show. So the party was over, the concert was over, the project was close to being done, and that's when we stepped in. That was way too late. So I know you guys know about this, and several other speakers mentioned it, but I think this is really crucial to implementing quality assurance in a company that cannot really afford having 5 or 6 people working on a single project, or even one person working full-time on a single project, is that you have to be involved in the steps prior so you can influence it in a particular way, in a more significant way than just finding crucial bugs at the very end. So I think this is, without this, you cannot really progress in 2019 with QA anymore. So you need to be more left, you need to start at the requirements phase, even at the kickoff phase when the clients explain what they want. Your QA people should be present, so they know what to expect in the future, to know how to influence stuff earlier. Another thing I always often heard is being T-shaped, so I think this is a very, very convenient way of looking at quality assurance people, is that, okay, you should be able to test well and know all of the testing stuff well, but there's a lot of stuff you could know that would help you a lot in being a better person. So because you don't just want to be a tester, even though there's nothing wrong with being a tester, you want to sort of escalate, you want to be more. You want to have more influence, because in the end, just testing won't make quality software, right? It's a part of it, it's a very crucial part of it, but it's not enough, at least in my experience. Okay, so instead of the ladder, we need something new. We need a new sort of tester, maybe a Tesla, maybe something that's a bit faster, a bit more, has a bit more features and a bit more capabilities. So here's how I managed to do that as a team lead in the past 3 years. And some of the categories I found were very important in building up the team. So there are 4, basically. I managed to get 4 out of it. So it's context, variety, collaboration, and knowledge. So these are the keys to building, for me, a really successful, a really T-shaped, a very able quality assurance team. So what is context? So on my first day on the job, I tried to Google, OK, how do I test this app? And this really gave me no answers. Why? Because there is no silver bullet in quality assurance. There's no silver bullet in any of the software engineering disciplines, but there's really no silver bullet in testing. So each project really needs a different sort of approach. And I hear people, and there's this sort of jump to automation. Like, the first thing you want to do, and this is on a couple of days after I started working, is I've been reading some stuff online. Everyone's mentioning automation, and we should automate testing. And I was completely unaware of the context. The context was that we are doing small mobile apps that have to be shipped fast, that we don't have the skills within the company to do it, and we don't really have time, and also that there's not real need for it. Because when we tried doing it, and we tried doing it well, we found out that the return on investment was quite bad for us to do UI testing, for instance, automated. So we left this part of the story on some projects to developers, and we ourselves tried to do something else. So there's this big push to automate everything, and I'm all for it in certain scenarios, but each project has a different context, and you have to have another different testing strategy for it. So you know that Kanner and Bach always say about context-driven testing that there are good practices in context, but there are no best practices. So you cannot just... I know there was a discussion yesterday about whether there should be manual testing, whether it's going to die or not. I think that's a very bad discussion, actually, because it really depends on the context of what you're doing. I mean, if you're working in the aviation industry, it's not the same as doing a small self-care app for your telecom company. It's absolutely different. And for us at Infinum especially, so for us, user experience is really the name of the game. And we realized that focusing most of our work on improving user experience through QA stuff, part of which is absolutely testing, is we can get much better results than doing scripts that very often bring us a lot of value, especially in some smaller mobile apps we're doing. So as you know, user experience has a lot of categories within it. And we found that automation won't really touch most of these. You might get an app that's useful, you might get an app that's more useful or more usable, but the rest really relies somewhere else, whether in the, whether it's the design phase or in the refinement phase, but you have to work much earlier and not put all of your money or all your chips into automation after the fact. At least that's my opinion, but it again depends on the context. In some situations, you could. Okay, so as I said, this is just a part of your job. And I don't think that QA should grow up in the sense of just becoming developers or coders or people who write automated test scripts on whatever level. Is it UI or end-to-end or integration or whatever? I think that can be a part of the job. It's good if you know it. And in some scenarios, it's very valuable. But it doesn't mean if all of your test cases are passing and you have all of your green checks on your continuous integration servers that your product is any good. It means that it works. It works in some situations, that some checks are passing. It might do something, but it doesn't mean that it's any good. It's a very terrible metric for the quality of your software, actually. And how do I know this? I know this because if you look at the retention rates for mobile apps, and this is partly due to competition in the last couple of years, they're horrible. I mean, and most of these apps, if you look at them, are not really bug prone. They're not full of bugs and issues and crashing. So it's not that's moving people away from these apps. So for instance, on the first day after the installation, almost a third of users will uninstall whatever app they get. And after 7 days, it's going to move up to 70% and just keeps rising, a bit more slower though. So the way to quality software is partly the idea that your client has or your customer has, but it's partly the execution of the entire story before the whole testing story comes in. So it's not just passing all checks and saying, okay, I've done my test cases, now my app is good, I've done my job. You haven't done your job, actually. There's much more you can do. So how can you adapt to this changing context to a different way of working? So you have to be present before any code is written, because most bugs actually happen before. So yes, they are in code, but most of them, at least from my experience, come either from miscommunication, bad refinement, people not being aware of what they have to do, missing acceptance criteria, and stuff that's not really, I made a coding error, because coding errors are usually resolved by developers, but the problem is that they do the wrong things, because they're unaware of what they have to do. Finding a new test strategy for every project, so there's no silver bullet. Recognizing the value of exploratory testing in some situations. I know that some companies are very afraid of doing it, thinking that, okay, this is totally uncontrolled, it's chaos, what are you going to do with it? But we found that it brings actually a lot of value quite fast, and for our sort of scenario, that works well often. And always keeping the Pareto principle in mind. So focusing on the 20% of features that your users will use the most, that are most important, focusing on the 20% of test cases that are most valuable to you, so really knowing what is crucial for success. Okay, so that was context. The second thing I think is very important is variety, and this is more of my experience as a team lead and someone who actually employs people to do testing, which is quite difficult to do in Croatia, which is a small company. I ask myself, okay, how do we build a better QA team, or how did we do it? And we actually employed people willing to learn and people with variety. One of the reasons we had to do it, actually, was the dilemma of employing developers to do QA is absolutely unsolvable, so you cannot really do it. Developers want to code, they want to create features, they want to create their apps. Very often, they want to do unit testing if they are smart about it, but they don't really do quality assurance full-time. And it's very hard to employ them as quality assurance engineers, at least in Croatia, but I think it's the case in other parts of the world as well. Employing experienced testers to do quality assurance is equally as hard because there are no experienced testers. There are some in some companies, but they're usually satisfied with their jobs, and it's very hard to get them to your company. And so you're in a really deadlock situation there. You cannot get developers or other IT people to come work in QA, and the people who know how to do it are very few, far in between, and hard to employ. And you need them, right? So the thing we did and how we employed all of these people is that we had to go a bit wider. We had to look into variety. And most of these people actually, and some of them are here in the audience, are not computer science majors, which is usually sort of the thing you look for in a QA engineer, anyone working in the software industry. They come from different backgrounds. And even though we were a bit afraid in the beginning of, okay, how the hell do we employ a designer or a psychologist or an economist or someone who did education in college to do quality assurance, it actually turned out pretty good. It actually turned out better than expected because they had no preconceived notion of what quality assurance really is. But they did have useful domain knowledge. They had really good soft skills. They did have some sort of attention to detail and willingness to learn and adapt to the projects we were working on, and also brought a fresh perspective on things. So if you work on a mobile banking app, for instance, someone with domain knowledge from economy, for instance, can bring you a lot of value that a typical QA person won't. And for the very fact that they weren't computer science majors, they were very, very willing to learn about new things. So they weren't really stuck in their ways. They didn't come from another company that just did test cases or automation, and then all they wanted to do in Finum was that. They were willing to do whatever needs to be done to do good projects. Okay, so we talked about context and variety. Another thing is collaboration, and I think this one is actually quite crucial. So I don't think any tester is an island. I find it very sad. I found it very sad in the beginning, how we were sort of relegated to the corner. We had our devices. We were testing the app. But we weren't really communicating with anyone. So the entire day was come to the office, take a few phones or a few computers or whatever, install the builds on several phones and test and be on your own most of the time. For me, that was kind of sad, and it wasn't the sort of way I think anyone should do software, really, because it's always a team effort. And as I said earlier, most bugs that do happen do stem from a lack of collaboration. So in our case, in our process, where the designers do really intricate designs upfront, often there's a miscommunication, a misunderstanding between the teams. So where the devs don't really know either how the design should work or how it should look, how it should behave, and what the client really wants. And this really needs a sort of a team to work on stuff, to communicate amongst each other. So you cannot, bugs happen because there's this gap between all of us in the team. So because the developer does one thing, no one really explained to him what needs to be done. He didn't ask for additional information. Additional information was not provided. They maybe don't have the skills to get the additional information. No one really thought about the implications and the risk on the entire system, because no one usually knows the system so well or the system as good as QA. So most of the bugs came from this sort of area. It wasn't really coding errors. It wasn't really people not willing to do their job. It was this lack of collaboration that caused a lot of issues. And as all people writing about software testing will always tell you, it's always a team effort. So you cannot really get to quality unless you're doing something extremely trivial if it's not a team effort. And when I say team, I mean absolutely everyone working on it. So QA and design and developers, project managers, owners, scrum masters, whatever, they all have to be involved and they all have to give their input into the project to make it any good. And you'll have still, even then, you'll have problems, but without that, you'll probably not get very far. Okay, and I didn't obviously come up with this. We've known this for a while, especially if you look at the Agile Manifesto, which everyone probably knows. It's all about individuals and interactions. So this is a part where we were sort of lacking as QA team, and also in customer collaboration, because we were very far removed from the client. We didn't actually know what had to happen. And this is something I've been trying to change for the past couple of years, at least from my position as a team lead of the QA team. So here are some maybe more practical examples of what you can do with people working on your projects to collaborate better, to get better software in the end. So in working with product owners, for instance, you have to understand the product they want to build. The only way to do that is to talk to them. So as a tester, I think the most valuable tool you have is your mouth and your tongue and your ability to speak to people and communicate and really extract the information you need to do your job well. You also, at every point in time, and this is something I stress to people in my team very often, is you have to attack the acceptance criteria. Attack in the way that first have people come to you when this stuff is created. Have people refine stuff with you. Have people take your input, because no one knows the product you are working on better than a software tester, right? Because they live with it every day. so the developer codes it, but you live with it. You test it every single day, you're with it every single day, you know all the nooks and crannies, all the cases, everything that could happen, where things can fall apart. So whenever something new is going to be added to the project, the person you have to come to is the tester, the quality assurance person on the project, because no one actually knows it better. And if they don't come to you, you should come to them. So if they're not inviting you to the meetings where stuff is refined, where stuff is being organized, you should get there somehow to do your job well. Same things go with the definition of ready. I've seen a lot of lazy product owners who don't really want to mess about with this stuff. They just want to scribble stuff down and then give the user stories to the team and expect magic is going to happen. And in the end, what happens? They wonder why the product didn't turn out well, because they're not really satisfying the definition of ready. And I think that the QA team's concern should be the definition of ready. So should be the way work is prepared, how it's questioned before the fact, so maybe in refinements. You should play the most active role of the entire sort of sprint. So the refinements are the meeting where you can give a lot to stop the bugs ever getting into the code and asking the good questions in time. Again, there's the thing that testers usually complain about is deadlines, so you cannot forcibly change it. But if you present a major risk to your client and say, hey, we cannot go to production with this, our customers are going to suffer, and if you argument it well enough, you show them the bugs and the things not working, they're not crazy. The deadlines can always change. The deadlines are never fixed in stone. But you have to be the one leading the charge. And OK, keep the backlog prioritized and the bugs, that's obvious. OK, when working with designers, in the beginning, they weren't at all aware what we were doing. Some of them still aren't. But you can work with the design team a lot, especially on the sort of projects we work on. So you can test the prototypes they make that will end up being the app in the end, find the missing flows, find the problems, find how it interacts with the existing app, or find missing screen states. So for instance, whenever you have some sort of list or an error, something meaningful should happen that informs the user. And you people usually miss that part of the story because they're so focused on the main feature, they never think about the edge cases and the problems. And you as the tester can really give your input in this part of the process as well. Together, you can also do design reviews and testing. So no one ever told the designers that they could do testing as well. But you can. So you can take them by the hand, test with them, and get their input on things because they're much better designers than you are, understand the design better. They'll see the issues that you don't. Another thing you can do is, since your app will be used by people, you can sort of start this thing of doing usability testing, gathering people, giving them the app, gathering feedback from them. Because after a while, you sort of become blind to the bugs, and you need other people to find them. OK, and you can help bring designers and developers together, because they so often can't really communicate well, because they speak a different language. OK, obviously, with developers, you can work as well, uncover the test cases and better solutions together, as I said, be active in refinements, see where things can break, design the tests up front, if possible. Debugging and covering root causes is obvious. Also, you can join an estimating work. What I often see is that QA is never asked about estimates. Even though they're not going to code the project, they can give their input on estimates. That's something I've been trying to do lately is, okay, asking the QA team, what do you guys think? Is 3 days enough for this? And even though they can't really code it, they sort of always have this good gut feeling about where things could become a bit complicated and messy and where we're going to start being late. Delivering structured and consistent bug reports is obvious. And this fifth thing is more of a sort of a Scrum Master role. I'm not saying you should be a Scrum Master, but when there are difficult problems you're aware of, it's your duty to rally and organize the team around and not just create a bug in Jira and then go home and watch TV. OK, a new thing we've started doing, which is, I think, very interesting, it's going to be a big part of the future, is data analysis. So if you want to know what your app should look like, you should ask the big questions. And one of the ways to find it is by metrics, capturing what people are doing. And this is something you can work with your data analyst as well to analyze and the retention rates and the crash rates and user feedback and what people are doing, and then take that information to lead sort of to a better app. But that people usually don't even do that. They're not even aware of it. But as a QA person, you need this information as well. And work with other testers, because you should share information. You should remove testers' fatigue. This is what often happens. If someone's been working on a project for a very long time, they start being blind. They don't see the forest for the trees. And they can't really know whether they're doing a good job or they're just used to the problems. So this is a very good point which you can come in and help people actually do a better job. Okay, so you should sort of aim to be the central, I at least think, you are sort of the central node of your project. You're not the most important person, but you basically should communicate with everyone. Not everyone communicates to everyone, but you should, and you can be this good carrier of information, sort of. Okay, and the last thing is knowledge, and I believe strongly that your company should grow you, so both as a tester, but also grow you as a person that understands good design, good code, and good ways of doing software, which for me currently is an agile way of doing things, at least for our company. Some things we did to get there, to get to this knowledge sharing point, we have this sort of handbook. It's like a small book of experiences, tools, tutorials we assembled for ourselves internally, so we can share knowledge between testers and actually have this repository of gathered experience through the years, and we keep updating it. Also, some of the other things we do in the company to spread knowledge, we have a small library of QA books which people can read. We do workshops every week, and these workshops are not always, okay, how to test or how to write test cases or how to automate testing. They can also be how to be assertive, how to talk to people, how to be a better communicator, better at meetings, better at spreading your influence. Okay, we also attend conferences. We talk one-on-one every week about apps, problems that may have, stuff like that, and attend development design academy we have at Infinum, but I won't go into detail there. Okay, so let's wrap it up. So we talked about context, knowledge, variety, and collaboration. So where do we sort of go from here? What's the point of the entire story? So my initial question was, why does a growing software company need a QA team, need a growing QA team? And sort of my answer to that question is, I think, okay, they absolutely need a QA team, especially the sort of company that we are, which is, we have a lot of people, we have a lot of small projects, we need someone sort of to lead the way, to sort of grow both the company, the processes around it. Those are people, I mean, people in QA usually inspire growth because they grow both themselves and the project, and in the long run, the company as well. So we need QA to keep growing as a company. And if you do it well, I think that's absolutely possible. I mean, people are usually very skeptical about their place in organizations. They think they don't really matter, that their job is just this small part of everything. But I think you can grow yourself and then grow the company as well. Okay. So to summarize quickly what I think QA should be in software companies, or what it is, it's that we are people that coordinate with everyone, basically. So as I talked about earlier, coordinate with everyone on projects. No projects inside out, because we live with them, and no one else really does other than the customer. So we're the original customer, in a sense. We know all the pitfalls of software development, because we are the first people who see stuff break, and we're the first people to know why it breaks. And where it breaks, and where the cracks and crevices in the processes are, so we should influence there. We are also the people that seek to improve products. So our main job, sort of, is to get this good thing we have and we are working on even better. But not only that, it's also our job, part of our job is to improve the processes that lead to it, because there's so much testing can do to get to a good product. Sometimes you have to stop testing, sort of go back, see how you got to where you are in order to improve. And I'll end with this quote from probably my favorite book on software testing, which is called Lessons Learned in Software Testing, which says that most projects, and I think that's true for a lot of people, most projects we're doing are more like driving a truck off-road, in the mountains, and at night. So I think this sounds familiar to everyone working in software. And these projects need headlights. They need someone to sort of drive them towards a better future. And as the tester, you light the way. So if your management ever asks you why you should expand and grow your QA team, you can always give them this quote and ask them, why would you rather walk instead of being a tester 2.0? Okay, that's it from me. Thanks for the attention. So I have some questions here on Slido. So it says, should I transfer the screen to here or? Yeah. Okay. So what kind of arguments were key for your boss for growing the QA team. Okay, so the main argument was always that the projects sort of need a quality leadership, because we had very young people as developers, because a lot of our developers are actually students. So it's hard to find developers in Croatia. And we want to grow as a company, so we actually employ a lot of students, a lot of young people, a lot of inexperienced people. There are not a lot of 40-year-old veterans in our company. And the argument was, okay, you need someone to sort of drive the project towards quality. So there were bugs, there were problems in communication, there were problems in software. And one of the reasons why we grew the QA team, because we saw that it helps. I mean, it helps on a daily basis. A person that communicates with everyone on the team, shares the information, knows the app very well, and also writes test cases and automates stuff and opens hundreds and hundreds of bugs, ultimately really grows the project. And actually, our clients noticed this as well. And after a while, they're looking for more QA people. So on some projects, we had a person working like 4 hours a day. It ended up being two people working 8 hours a day because the influence they had was so big. And this is what our bosses saw and then are trying to expand it as well. Okay. Maybe some. Yeah. Thank you.